Ladies and gents, welcome to the show.
Ladies and gents, welcome to the show.
If you ain't into poetry, I think it's time to go. We got a lot of lyrics that you see on the show. Yeah, yeah. Whenever they get finished, you gon' be wanting some more. Come over here and peep some of this poetry. Blowing with my lyrics, yeah, that's the meaning of poetry. I really like rhyming, that's your only way of knowing me. Tell your friends and family to come watch some neo soul. Ladies and gents, welcome to the show.
Neo soul, neo soul, neo soul.
If you ain't into poetry, I think it's time to go.
Neo soul, neo soul, neo soul.
We got a lot of lyrics that you see on the show.
Neo soul, neo soul, neo soul.
Whenever they get finished, you gon' be wanting some
soul. Neo soul, neo soul, neo soul.
Hello! I am here with Banneker Trojan TV for Neo Soul. My name is Zephaniah Jones.
And I'm Mr. Gerald Harris.
And I'm Aline Malukas.
And we are in the presence of real greatness tonight, people. Let me read you this line up real quick. First, we have Pascal. Then we have Dr. Dawn Ogletree. Next, we have Prayer. Then we have Ms. Bess. And last but not least, myself and my dear friend Callie.
Trojan Nation is breaking down generation barriers through music, poetry, and artwork. And I'm really excited to see it.
Mm-hmm. Sit back and relax.
All right, now, let's get into our first topic. Did y'all see this Pepsi commercial that Kendall Jenner did?
Yes, I did.
We saw it, and I absolutely hated it.
Why did you hate it?
Well, here's my thing, right? It's with the idea that Kendall Jenner is just giving the officer a Pepsi and all is well. People are celebrating the whole nine yards. But let's go back some. We can't say that just by handing an officer a Pepsi is just going to solve whatever issues that was going on. Here's a little background, right? So in the commercial, Kendall Jenner, she's tone deaf. All she's seeing right now is other people in celebration. Some are mad, some are upset, some are crying. Mm-hmm. And out of nowhere, she picks up a Pepsi out of a cooler and starts walking toward an officer. And once the officer takes his first sip, it's like the aha moment, like, ah, all is well. Mm-hmm. But when I watched the commercial, I couldn't just help but think about Trayvon Martin and Mike Brown and Sandra Bland. What about those people? Should they have just given the officer a Pepsi and everything would have been okay? No, that's not what would have happened. What would have happened, exactly what happened, you have blood on the streets of America because of just negligence.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that Pepsi, I like the attempt to bring awareness to something, but I feel as if they dropped the ball on that one.
They really did, yeah. Well, honestly, I feel like it's kind of like more of a future outlook. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like Pepsi was doing a thing and was trying to, you know, look into the future of what we can do, what we can accomplish as a society and as a whole. You know what I mean? So I feel like, you know, as a society, Pepsi was doing a good thing and saying, hey, if we just all just shared a Pepsi or a Coke or, you know, even a Dr. Pepper from time to time, maybe we wouldn't be in so much hate and so much crime and stuff.
But a refreshing beverage doesn't bring a child back. That doesn't bring a mother back her son. Or that doesn't bring a niece or a daughter back to a family. A Pepsi or refreshing beverage doesn't do that. Now, I am in agreement with some of our fellow civilians here in America by boycotting Pepsi, but in boycotting Pepsi, we have to boycott all of the businesses that are in partnership with Pepsi. And I don't know about y'all, but I do like my Tropicana orange juice. I do like my KFC. So I'm on the fence because, like I said, I appreciate the effort, but I do feel as if they dropped the ball and they forgot about the families who've lost loved ones due to things like police brutality.
Mm-hmm.
We just had a bombing overseas. Like, come on, like a refreshing beverage, is that supposed to solve the world's problems? No. So let's not put that fantasy out there, is what I'm saying.
I agree with both of y'all points, but I feel that it's also makes it's a start because it shines the light on issues such as this, and that people have sometimes could be ignorant to issues like this and ignore it. So putting it out there makes people be like, oh, this is actually happening. Oh, I should notice it. And maybe we can even talk about it in school.
It is a conversation starter, and that's where I definitely agree with you on that. And I'm glad people are having a conversation, because it is the conversation that needs to happen, mm-hmm. especially in 2017 moving forward, where we have leaders who, at the drop of a dime, will do anything crazy. So I definitely agree.
Mm-hmm. But, you know, don't you feel like, you know, Beyonce should have been, you know, the spokesperson instead of old Kendall Jenner?
Now, Beyonce, she has been doing Pepsi commercials for a long time now, and she is the most valuable person on social media. So I have to give it to Pepsi. Hey, if you can't get it with the Kardashians, you may need to bring it back to the Knowles Carters and go with Beyonce or Blue Ivy. Or, hey, then maybe the twins. They're getting ready to be born, I think.
right. Honestly, I, for once, I agree with you on that one, all right? So, all right, now we are going to get into our first interview. Our first,
oh my God. Pascal?
Yes, Pascal, yes. We are going to get into our first guest tonight. His name is Pascal Colley. He is from Atlanta, Georgia. Well, that's where I know him from. He could have been from anywhere in the globe. But you know, for right now, he is from Atlanta, Georgia. All right, he is going to share some art with us. But after we hear from Tyrus from the Trumpet Awards. Mm.
Hey, I am Tyrus Harding, representing Banneker High School and Neo Soul for the 25th Annual Trumpet Awards. Right now, I'm going to be honest, I'm feeling kind of jittery, and I don't know what's going to happen, but so far they gave me this little cheat sheet that these are the people that I might see, so let's hope everything goes good.
It means a lot to me because 25 years is a long time. I mean, I wasn't even born when this here was incepted. So, I mean, it really means a lot to be here. So I'm just glad to be here with all, you know, people like yourself and, you know, all these other people, and the older people here. It's a great thing. And, you know, we need these type of awards, but we need to come to these type of awards, too, though.
That's what really matters.
Yes, honey. If you got an award, then you need to be here to receive it. Mm-hmm. So you shouldn't be honored.
Oh, yeah. Not at all.
Mm-hmm.
Or, giving a suggestion, they could just mail it.
You know, you don't mess with, honey, if you go to the Oscars and the Grammys, not too many people don't get their Oscars and Grammys. They be there to get their awards, so, honey, that means so you need to be at the Trumpets to get your award.
It feels really good. Like I was saying earlier, anything that celebrates black excellence, I'm all for it. So it's great to be back. It's great to be a part of it. And I'm just happy to be here. I want to see, you know, who we get to celebrate and honor this year.
Wow. When I say everyone looked good, and I was just waiting to just nitpick at something. So, who do we have here?
Oh, yes. My friend, my dear friend, Pascal Colley. Hello, sir. Let's start with where you're from. Okay, I only know you from Atlanta, Georgia, but where are you originally from?
Oh, I'm Pascal Colley, and I'm from Liberia, Africa, West Africa.
Oh, West Africa. Okay, yeah. Okay. So, what basically touched you into art? What's your passion? What made you, you know?
Art, let me see. Art is like a closure for me. It's a way like I can get away from society. So whenever I do art, it's like I imagine something else different. And it's more than like you were just saying recently about the Pepsi stuff. Mm-hmm. Art take me away from that and take me somewhere else. And I can bring something else and some people can focus on it instead of all the violence and stuff. Mm. So that is like my inspiration to art. That's why I keep doing it.
Oh, wow. Yes. Would you like to touch on anything, Alima?
How much do you sell your art for?
My art, I usually sell copies for $100. I sell my original work for about $5,000. It depends. And that's how much I retail myself for, because I think I'm a really good artist, mm-hmm. and I put a lot of work into it. And if I can express myself through a painting and make someone else feel, and someone else can relate to it, I feel like that's something worth sharing, and that's something worth more than money. And selling it can be hard for me. That's mostly why I don't sell my originals, but I would sell it for $5,000
Lima. Okay.
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
What's like your go-to color when you're painting on a canvas? What's your go-to color? Mm. I guess the color that you connect with the most.
I tend to use red a lot because red is not a happy color. Red is more like something bad. And when I use red in my painting, it's trying to say that is pain, that is more like anger. But I'm gonna mix it up with more like white, red, because I like to do abstract work. But I say red is my go-to color.
So with red being your go-to color, and it meaning pain and anger, like you said, has there been some sort of trauma in your life that kind of triggers that?
Yes. Back to where I'm from. I'm from, like I said, I'm from Africa. When I was born in 98, like 2002, there was a war in my country, and it went on for like 3 years, 3 to 4 years, and the war ended in like 2007. So half of my life I've been like in chaos. So like I said, my art took me away from that, and I'm trying to show people the light through art. That's why I do it. But that's why I use red. It's just my background is not like, it's not all bright colors. It's more anger. And if I can put it on a canvas and just look at it instead of keeping it in, I feel good about it.
Your current project, what does it mean to you? Let's just start there.
My current project. What it means to me. Right now, I'm not painting more about me no more. I'm painting about society and how it is. So my current project lately, I've been painting something like, people should focus on what is happening in society instead of the media. Mm. Like, a lot of people would like pictures on social media that don't even have nothing to do with the harsh thing that is happening in society. So I'm trying to make paintings that actually, like recently I did a painting with Rose and a figure drawing. We symbolize he is alone. And a lot of people feel alone in society because we all got to depend on someone for like closure. That's how human beings live. That's how we live. But my most recent painting, I'm focusing on how can I like show people something different than maybe a SpongeBob cartoon saying, we should go watch SpongeBob. Mm. Show them something that says, you know what? People are dying in some part of the world right now. There's dirty water. And that means more than the cartoon that you spend your time on thinking it's cool. Mm-hmm. So right now I'm working on stuff like that.
He answered all your questions?
My question is about your name. Do you know where that like came from or why your mother named you that?
Pascal. Pascal means born on Easter, because mm-hmm. I was born on Easter.
Wow.
Yeah, that's amazing. I wasn't named by my parents. I was named by some African man. His name is Pascal. I don't really know his full background story. He do petroleum oil and stuff like that. But he named me Pascal because he said since I was born on Easter, and Pascal means born on Easter. So that's how I got my name, Pascal.
Okay. All right.
Yeah.
What's next for you? Like, what's the next? You're so young, and you have an amazing talent, but what's next? Do you have anything that you can think of, whether it be some new rendition of the whole Sip and Stroke, since Sip and Stroke here in Atlanta is really a big trend? People are doing it for their birthdays and different celebrations. Do you have any projects that you're working on to kind of take you to the next level? Like, I would love to see a gallery. You featured in a big art gallery here in Atlanta.
What's next for me? That's a good question, because recently I got featured in the Scholastic's Art and Writing Essay in Savannah, Scott, Atlanta. Mm. And I actually won an award for a piece I did, which is called Deep Affection. Mm. So what next to me is Art of the God. And I can really plan that, because I will keep on trying. If I love art as much as I do, it's going to love me back one day. So I don't really know what's next for me, but I know God knows what's next for me.
Love it.
Yeah. All right. Next on our agenda is Dr. Don Ogletree. But first, Let's go back to Tyrus and that Trumpet Awards. Let's see what's going on next.
What's up, my brother? How you doing, man?
I'm doing good.
You got a young man on interviewing people. That's what I like to see right here. How are you, 12?
Well, I'm 13.
13?
Don't tell anyone, though. Nah,
I like
18.
That.
Yeah.
You 18 years old? Oh, wow, I like that. Since you started early.
Mm-hmm. Oh, man. Oh, but would you mind telling me how does it feel to be here this year?
For my first time? Yeah. The 25th anniversary, it feels absolutely phenomenal. You know what I mean? I have never been to the Trumpet Awards. I'm always at home watching the Trumpet Awards, talking about people. So for me to be here, I could talk about them in their face. That's what I like about being here.
That's good right
there. This is fun.
What projects do you currently have going on outside?
Well, I got the Ed Lover Show with Moni Love, nationally syndicated show through Radio 1. You can catch me on Ricky Smiley For Real. I got that. I got my own television show coming called The Agency. Doing a book called The Man, The Myth, The Legend, and The Fool. So that's coming out soon. And you can catch me doing stand-up on a stage somewhere around this country any night of the week. Atlanta Comedy Theater tonight with my cousin Talent. So I'm working. I'm always working.
That's pretty good right there.
So I keep these pockets full with money.
Man, I'm so happy to be here. My first time here at the Trumpet Awards, and we're actually presenting. Make sure that you check out David Mann and I. We're going to have an amazing time acting up. We are. Yeah. Thank you, guys. Have a blessed
week. You too. I'm hosting the 25th Annual Trumpet Awards with Dion Cole, and it's good to be back in the A. I used to live here when I started my family, so I'm feeling really good tonight, and so many amazing people are here, and we're going to have a good show. I'm Nicole Ari Parker, and you are watching Neo Soul Television.
Well, how are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Pretty good.
Oh my gosh, it feels excellent. I'm so happy to be here, you know, supporting Black excellence, and it's going to be a good night.
It is. I can feel it. I already see Nicole and
Kiki over there.
Oh.
Exciting. No.
How does it feel to be here for the 25th anniversary?
Yeah, it feels wonderful to celebrate Black excellence and to see ourselves in so many different lights, from politics to philanthropy, entertainment. It's wonderful. Hi, I'm Jasmine Burke from Fox's Star, and you're watching Neo Soul TV.
But how are you doing today?
I am great. I'm ecstatic. I'm getting ready to honor my friend, Mr. Peabo Bryson. So what could be better than that? To do anything for 25 years and do it successfully is really something to blow your horn about. Pardon the pun.
It's called talent.
A whole new world, a dazzling place I never knew. But now from way up here, it's crystal clear. That now I'm making a whole new world with you.
Thank you. Thank you, Miss Bell.
It's live.
Man, oh man, oh man. Oh, we back from that Trumpet Awards, man. I'm starstruck already, and I ain't even there. All right, we are here with Dr. Don Ogletree. So, Dr. Ogletree.
Yes.
When did you first find out your passion? When did you first discovered it?
I first discovered my passion when I was a little boy. I'm the youngest of 10 children, and in my home is a piano. And every one of my brothers and sisters learned to play on that piano, and so it was just passed down. And so I would go to that piano and pick out melodies, and then I went, wow, this is really interesting, and I had a talent for that, so I would pick out songs and begin to play by ear. So it just sort of, I don't know so much that I chose music as if it chose me.
Oh, I like that. I like that so much. Oh my gosh, that hit me right there. Okay. I'm sorry.
What's your favorite song?
Wow, my favorite song. I have so many. I would probably say that my favorite song is a song that I wrote, and it's entitled "The Lord Will Supply Your Every Need."
Oh, can you sing us a little tune real quick? Just get a little feel of, you know, what it is.
Well, it starts out, let me give you a little bit of history. It starts out talking about there's a particular scripture where a lady had an issue of blood. She had been sick for years and years and years, and she couldn't find an answer to become healed. Jesus was traveling throughout the land, and she eventually became in his company, and she touched his clothes. And because she touched the hem of his garment, virtue came out of Jesus, and she was healed instantly from that. So it's all about the power that Jesus has and her life being transformed. And so the whole thing, the reason why I do what I do is because it's important for us to have purpose in life. So when I think about the reason that Jesus was born and the reason why he was here, I too have a purpose, and so I write music to impact the lives of other people. And when we think about the previous artist that you had, Pascal, he mentioned about desiring to paint with red, using the color red because it represented pain.
Mm-hmm.
It's all about purpose and it's all about people. And so I write to impact the lives of people in a positive way.
Thank you. Oh, wow. Okay, I like that. I like that.
Where does the doctor stem from? Like, where are you a doctor in?
I'm a doctor of education, educational administration and leadership. And so I went through a prescribed course of study at a university, and because I've been an educator for many, many years, I wanted to attain a certain level of knowledge and competence in that area, and so that was the reason I pursued my doctorate degree.
But I want to know from you, what are your top three songs that best to kind of describe who you are? So if someone were to just come up to you and say, hey, tell me about your personality and song, what three songs come to your mind right now?
To be honest with you, I don't think that I could give you top three songs that would really tell you who I am and what I'm about. Because first of all, I like all genres of music. I like hip-hop, I like R&B, I like gospel, I like classical. And I believe that everybody and every artist that's ever lived has had something positive to say, and they've made an impact on society. And people are making a difference with whatever genre appeals to them. So I don't like just one genre. I can think of country and western music that I like. So it's, to be honest with you, I can't just pick one, two, or three titles or even genres. I just like it all.
I've had the pleasure of knowing you for about 2 years now, and I've seen you in several roles, and I must say he is phenomenal in everything that he does. Dr. Ogletree, you mentioned being a fan of hip-hop. Question for you. Comparing hip-hop to what it originated as, to what it is now, what are your thoughts? Do you think hip-hop still exists, the integrity of it?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I believe hip-hop exists today. But what we have to realize and understand is that music is transformative. It's a process, and music starts, it has an inception point or point at which it begins, and then it evolves. And so hip-hop, back in the day, when we look at Tupac Shakur and his impact on society, he had a message, and he was impacting the world from a cultural perspective, and he had a message for the people. Today, that's not necessarily the case. Be that as it may, the reality is that many of our artists, and this is not a put down, it's just a simple fact, right, that many of the artists are, you know, working to make a quick buck because it's lucrative to do it. And so they take an art form that has been used in the past and they use it as a platform to gain financial wealth. And I'm not knocking that, there's nothing wrong with it. But when you asked me about the original purpose for hip-hop, and when it was used initially, it was all about a message, and it was all about social consciousness. Mm. Whereas today, I do think that some artists are approaching it from that perspective, but not all of them. And so in some form or another, yes, hip-hop still exists today. But we have to also understand that hip-hop basically involves four different things. It's DJing, graffiti, rapping, you know, so that's three of the four. So when we look at those aspects of music, and if those elements are missing, then it may not be what it was back in the day. But again, the biggest distinction is the raising of social consciousness.
Could it turn out that the person's passion be bad? You understand? Like, because I understand that some hip-hop, maybe most hip-hop today, a lot of our generation is taking the wrong way completely, and it's lead to killings, the mistreatment of women, or, you know, vice, you know, everything in between that category. So do you think that necessarily that person's passion could be bad?
I wouldn't say that a person's passion is bad. I think passion is a good thing, and passion is and can be a motivator for people to do this or that. How someone else reacts to someone else's passion is different. I may say something, or we look at what happens even in the political arena. one politician says something and somebody else who's maybe from a different party will receive what that person said and interpret it completely differently. So I think that there are people hearing messages and are interpreting it and using it for their own personal gain or are projecting meaning on what is being said to support their particular agenda.
While we're on the hip-hop topic, have you ever rapped or wanted to rap before?
I have wanted to rap, but I have no skill in that. We have to know what our lane is and stay in it. And I think that there's a learning curve involved with everything. I've not practiced that. I've not engaged in that kind of thing. Now, I have been a nightclub musician, and I performed R&B music back in the day when I was doing nightclubs.
Okay.
The doctor.
All right.
Yes,
right.
The doctor.
I love it. And I, you know what interests me? I would love to see you behind the table, just doing your thing, just DJing. So we have to hook that up in some way, form or fashion. We have to make that happen because I would love to see. And that could be your name, the doctor. And you're on the table, just doing your thing.
Doctor O.
As an educator, I think it's important that we expose ourselves. And that we always continue to grow. We should always be open to learning new things. And I am open to that, but we've got to understand that I certainly would be out of my lane and there would be new skills that I would be acquiring. But I'm completely open. So let's do it.
Awesome. Well, Dr. Ogletree, first of all, I have to say thank you. Again, you are great at what you do, and the world needs to know that. Young educators like myself, we take so much from people like you and the wisdom that you share with us going into the industry. You are a sound mind on many days and just by observation. So again, thank you for what you do.
Thank you.
All right. I enjoyed this interview with you, Dr. Don Ogletree. So next we're going to take a fresh look at his video, The Lord Will Supply Your Every Need.
Remember the woman who touched the Lord's robe to get well? She had heard of the works of Jesus and knew that he would not fail. She touched his garment and was healed with great power. Faith had made her well. She was healed in that hour. I know the Lord will supply your need. Ooh, as I look back over my life, I realize I've had some ups and downs.